Hi everyone, Namaste. I hope all are doing good. So in the last class, we started solution chapter. So some important concentration terms. So also Henry's law, Raoult's law we completed. So in the last class, so we completed the addition of a volatile solute in the solvent. How the vapor pressure will be changed. That is given by Raoult's law. So Raoult's law says that in a mixture of volatile components, the partial pressure of each component is directly proportional to its mole fraction. Those solutions which obey Raoult's law are called ideal solutions, and which does not obey Raoult's law are called non-ideal solutions. So whose properties also we completed. Now we are seeing addition of a non-volatile solute in a solvent. So in a solvent, in the last class we added volatile solute. Now we are adding non-volatile solute. When we are adding non-volatile solute, what will happen to vapor pressure? We'll see. So see this. I'm taking a solvent. Let it be water. Here, surface water molecules are there. So because of surface molecules, they have weak forces of attraction. They can be easily evaporate and they exhibit some vapor pressure. But when we are adding non-volatile solute, so non-volatile means they cannot evaporate. So like NaCl, whatever. When we are adding non-volatile solute, so these non-volatile solute particles replaces the solvent particles like this. So because of non-volatile particles replaces solvent particles, so evaporation will be decreases. When evaporation decreases, definitely vapor pressure will be decreases. So the addition of non-volatile solute always decreases vapor pressure of the solvent. Remember, according to Raoult's law, if you are taking water solvent as a, the partial pressure of the water A is directly proportional to its mole fraction. According to Raoult's law, if you are taking equal, constant will come, that will be pure vapor pressure of the solvent. So this is the Raoult's law formula. Partial pressure of any component is equal to pure vapor pressure into XA. But in place of this XA, we can write 1 minus XB. So why? Because total mole fraction must be equal to 1. So XA is equal to 1 minus XB. So from this, P naught A into 1, it will be P naught A minus P naught A XB, which is equal to partial pressure of solvent. So from this, so come this side, minus will come this side plus. So P naught A into XB equal to P naught A minus PA. From this, XB is equal to P naught A minus PA by P naught A. So this is very important formula. See this. Just I am using Raoult's law formula. Partial pressure of solvent equal to its pure pressure into its mole fraction. In place of solvent mole fraction, I am writing 1 minus into solute mole fraction. So from that, I am getting this formula. Here, it is the mole fraction of solute. Just A, I am taking a solvent. So B will be solute. The mole fraction of solute is equal to pure vapor pressure of solvent minus partial pressure divided by partial pressure. See this, this is the pure vapor pressure and this is the partial pressure. So this is nothing but change in vapor pressure. So due to addition of solute, how much it changed? So that is the this value, P naught A minus A. P naught A is a high value because solvent has more pressure because of addition of non-volatile solute. So partial pressure will be decreases. So this is the decrease in vapor pressure. So this is called lowering of vapor pressure. And this is divided by pure vapor pressure. So this total is called relative lowering of vapor pressure. Now this relative lowering of vapor pressure we are calling as a colligative property. So what are colligative properties? You will see now. So this is the relative lowering of vapor pressure. So from here we start colligative properties. Most important one, colligative properties.
First of all, what is the definition of these colligative properties? These are the properties which only depends on number of solute particles, but does not depends on nature of solute particles. So, in a given solvent, so which particles we are adding does not matter, but how many particles we are adding, so that is important. So, only colligative properties depends on number of particles. Suppose if you are adding Na plus ions, 1 mole of Na plus ions we are adding, or 1 mole of K plus we are adding. So both colligative property value will be same, because it is also 1 mole, it is also 1 mole. So the properties only depends on number of moles of solute particles, does not depends on nature of solute particles. Anything we can add, but how much we are adding, so that is a matter. So there are total 4 types of colligative properties. The first one is called relative lowering of vapor pressure. The second one is called elevation in boiling point. Third one is called depression freezing point. The fourth one is called osmotic pressure. So total 4 colligative properties. All these properties only depends on number of solute particles. How many solute particles we are adding? That is important. Now, already formula again, RLVP, relative lowering of vapor pressure, elevation in boiling point, depression in freezing point. So, how these are came? I'll explain in a simple way. See this, I'm taking H2O liquid as a solvent. This on heating, it is converted to vapor state. It is on cooling, it is converted to solid state. Just I have taken 3 states, solid, liquid and gas. So all of you know that among these 3 states, which has more pressure? So pressure is always high for gas, after that liquid. In solid particles, pressure will be negligible. Just take it, it is a 1 atmospheric pressure. Let it will be 0.5 atmospheric pressure. And it will be at 0.1 atmospheric pressure. Just values I am reading. Gas will be high pressure, liquid, solid will be very low pressure. Now say this, liquid converted to gas. So how we convert liquid into gas? Simply by heating. At which temperature liquid will convert into gas? That is called simply boiling point. So boiling point of water. Water I am taking, so this definitely 100 Celsius, or simply we can write in Kelvin, 373 Kelvin. Similarly, if liquid we have converted to solid, that is called freezing point, it should be 0 Celsius, that means 273 Kelvin. Now see this, so boiling point actual definition, all we know that boiling point means it is the temperature at which liquid is converted to gas. But the actual definition of boiling point is, pressure of liquid will be equal to pressure of gas. That is the main definition. Liquid pressure must be equal to gas pressure at which temperature? The temperature is called boiling point. Similarly, freezing point definition, the temperature at which the pressure of liquid will be equal to pressure of solid. So here 0.5 will become 1 at this 373 Kelvin, 0.5 will become 0.1 at this 273 Kelvin. This is for water. Just values are just imagining. So this is for pure solvent. But see this, in this water, suppose I am adding NaCl salt, a non-volatile salt I am adding. So when solute we are adding in solvent, the product is called solution. It is represented with aqueous state. Now say this, any non-volatile solute we are dissolving in solvent, so definitely vapor pressure will be decreases, already told, because surface solvent particles are replaced by solute particles, vaporization will be decreases, so vapor pressure will be decreases. So that means the solution vapor pressure will be less than the pure solvent. Here pure solvent I take it as 0.5, so solution will be less than 0.5. Take it as a 0.3 atmospheric pressure. That means
the vapor pressure of a solution is always less than the vapor pressure of pure solvent due to addition of non-volatile solute. So how much is decreased? Initially 0.5, but after adding solute it will become 0.3. So the decreased value we call delta P. So delta P formula, P naught minus P. So P naught means pure solvent, P means solution. So this will be 0.5 minus 0.3, so nearly 0.2. So this delta P is called lowering of vapor pressure. So this lowering of vapor pressure is always depends on amount of solute we are adding. If more solute we are adding, more decreasing is possible. So this is a colligative property. When we are related with P naught, so this is called relative lowering of vapor pressure. So vapor pressure always decreases due to addition of solute particle. Now say this, initially pressure is 0.5. If this 0.5 will be equal to 1 at temperature of 373 Kelvin. But due to addition of solute, pressure is decreased to 0.3. Now this 0.3 we are converted to 1 atmospheric pressure, that means gas. To make this solution into gas, the required temperature, see what will happen, temperature will increases or decreases. 0.5 we are taking into 1, required value will be 373 Kelvin. But here pressure is decreased, and pressure is decreased, so we have to increase more temperature to become 1 atmospheric pressure. So here the boiling point, that it will be 400 Kelvin. So that means the boiling point of a solution will be always more than the boiling point of pure solvent. So pure solvent is 373, but due to addition of solute, extra temperature will be required to make into gas. So how much is increased? That is called elevation in boiling point. Whenever we are adding solute, boiling point will be increases. That is called elevation in boiling point. It is represented with delta TV. This delta TV formula will be boiling point of solution will be high, you are taking as TV, minus solvent will be low, you are taking as T naught B. So 400 minus 370 will be nearly 27. That much will be increased due to addition of solute. Same way, if this 0.3 you are converted to 0.1 atmospheric pressure, what will happen to freezing point? Observe. Here it is 0.5. The change next to 0.1, required temperature will be 273. But if pressure already decreased is 0.3, it can easily convert it to 0.1. The required temperature will be less than the expected. Here we are taking suppose 250 Kelvin. So this is called freezing point of solution. So freezing point will be decreases, boiling point will be increases. Increase in boiling point is called elevation in boiling point. The decrease in freezing point is called depression in freezing point, represented with delta TF, which will be high value solvent T naught F minus TF. Wherever you are using naught, that means pure solvent, remember it. So pure solvent is one. This one is a pure solvent. So addition of solute decreases vapor pressure, increases boiling point, and decreases freezing point. So all this increasing, decreasing, decreasing, all depends on what? Amount of solute what we are adding. Does not depend on which solute we are adding, only depends upon how much amount we are adding. So all these properties will depends on number of solute particles. That's why all these are called colligative properties. Colligative properties only depends on number of solute particles. Vapor pressure will be decreases, that we are calling as relative lowering of vapor pressure. Boiling point will increases, elevation in boiling point. Freezing point will be decreases, that is called depression in freezing point. So any solvent, any non-volatile solute we are adding, pressure decreases, boiling point increases, freezing point decreases. All these values depends on how much amount we are adding. What we are adding is not matter. How much we are adding, that is important. Only depends on number of solute particles. So these formulas will say one by one. So the first first one is relative lowering of vapor pressure. The formula I already given. So P naught minus P by P naught is equal to mole fraction. Suppose we are taking solid. So this will be mole fraction of solid. So this is the formula. So pure vapor pressure of solvent minus partial vapor pressure of this solvent divided by pure vapor pressure. So this is called relative lowering of vapor pressure. It is always equal to mole fraction of solute. So this is mole fraction of solute important. Similarly, so formula we can write P naught A minus P A by P naught A is equal to mole fraction means number of moles of solute by total number of moles solvent plus solute. So for dilute solution, amount of solute is very less. So this NB we can neglect it. So directly we can write NB by NA. So this is for dilute solutions. Because in dilute solution, solute amount will be less. So NB we can neglect and then divide. So NB by NA, number of moles of solute by number of moles of solvent. So this is a important formula. So the second one is elevation in boiling point. So elevation in boiling point represented with delta TB. So delta TB formula already given. It is the TB minus T naught B, boiling point of solution minus boiling point of pure solvent. So solution will be always high because boiling point will increases due to addition of solute. High value minus low value. Experimentally, the calculated value of elevation in boiling point is directly proportional to molarity term. So this is experimental value. The calculated value of elevation in boiling point is directly proportional to molarity. So from this, delta TB is equal to, and constant will come, KB into molarity. And KB is called constant. It is called molar elevation constant, also called ebullioscopic constant. So the KB units always they will give. The KB units will be, M will come this side, so delta TB is the temperature, it should be in Kelvin. Kelvin, molarity units, mole per kg, but it is come divide side, it will become kg mole inverse. That is the units of KB. For water, the value of KB nearly 0.52. Remember this value, mostly KB value they will give, but for water, this will be 0.52. So KB for water this one, 0.52 value. So this is elevation in boiling point. So formulas are most important. So with the help of formulas, they will give numerical questions, qualitative property questions. So one question definitely will come from these four properties. Either relative lowering, elevation in boiling, depression increasing, or osmotic pressure. Similarly, the third one will be depression in freezing point. So depression in freezing point. So due to addition of solute, freezing point will be decreases. How much is decreasing? That is called delta TF. Its formula will be T naught F minus TF. So experimentally it is calculated. So delta TF is again directly proportional to molarity. From this, delta TF is equal to constant KF into molarity. This KF is called cryoscopic constant or molar depression constant. So either cryoscopic constant or molar depression constant. So KF also has same unit. KF is equal to delta TF by M. That means Kelvin kg mole inverse. For water, the KF of water will be 1.86. So KB of water, KF of water. So both constant values depends on nature of solvent what we are taking. So different solvents has different KF values. So, but for water, so we have to remember KF of water is 1.86, KV of water will be 0.52. So any other solvent is blend, so definitely they will give KF and KV values. This is depression and freezing point. So these three properties we completed. Now the fourth property is osmotic pressure. So before we go into osmotic pressure, so first we learn what is osmosis. Osmotic pressure is based on osmosis. First of all, what is osmosis? So it is a biology topic, all you know that. It is the process of transfer of solvent. Process of transfer of solvent, not solute, only solvent transfer. So it is a transfer of solvent from low concentration to high concentration. So most of you are confused, remember. So solvent always transferred from low concentration to high concentration. Why? Because in chemistry, concentration low means solvent will be high. Concentration high means solvent will be low. So solvent always transfer from high level to low level. But high solvent means low concentration. And low solvent means high concentration. That's why solvent always transfer from low concentration to high concentration through a semi-permeable membrane. So what is semi-permeable membrane? It has very microscopic holes which allows only small particles. So solvent particles are very small size when compared with solute particle. That's why through semi-permeable membrane only solvent particles can transfer. So this transfer of solvent from low concentration to high concentration is called osmosis. For example, see this. I am taking two beakers. So both of these beakers are here, suppose we are taking 5 molarity of NaCl solution. Here we are taking 2 molarity of NaCl solution. Both are 1 liter, 1 liter. This is also 1 liter solution. This is also 1 liter solution. So both volume is same. But here the concentration is 5 molarity. Here the concentration is 2 molarity. So see this. So if concentration is high, that means solute is high, that means solvent will be less. Here solute is less, that means solvent will be high. So here high solvent, here low solvent. So solvent always transfer from high solvent side to low solvent side through a semi-permeable membrane. So through this semi-permeable membrane, solvent is transferring from low concentration to high concentration. This transfer is called osmosis. During the osmosis, see this, when solvent is transferring, here amount will become less, here amount will become more. So whenever amount is coming this side, so some force exerts the piston. So on the piston, some force will be exerted. So that pressure, force by area, we are calling as pressure. So that pressure we are calling as osmotic pressure. So how much pressure exerted due to osmosis is called osmotic pressure. So due to passage of solvent, some pressure will become increases. That increased pressure is called osmotic pressure. So this osmotic pressure is denoted with pi. So this pi formula will be concentration into R into T. This is the formula, osmotic pressure formula. Okay, concentration if they take as molarity. So how the formula will get? So in states of matter, ideal gas equation, PV is equal nRT will be there. So from this pressure is equal n by V RT. So pressure is equal number of moles by volume. It's nothing but molarity into RT. So this is for gases, but for solutions, this P is replaced by pi. Osmotic pressure pi denoted molarity into R into T. R is the gas constant, P is the temperature. So molarity is also nothing but number of moles. So, if moles are more, osmotic pressure is also more. That's why it is also colligative property. Colligative property means which depends on number of solute particles. So here concentration is more, more solvent will be transferred, so more pressure will be exerted. So that is the osmotic pressure is a colligative property. So definition of osmotic pressure, the pressure exerted due to osmosis. But sometimes if you are applying pressure on the piston externally, when you are applying pressure on the piston, so whatever the solvent particles are coming, so it will be restricted. So to stop the osmosis, how much pressure we have to apply, that pressure is also called osmotic pressure. So both are same. So producing pressure or applied pressure, so both must be equal. So to stop the osmosis, how much pressure is required, that is also called osmotic pressure. So pi is equal to mRT, m is the molarity. So molarity formula is number of moles by volume. So total four colligative properties: relative lowering of vapor pressure, elevation in boiling point, depression in freezing point, and osmotic pressure. Now see this. If you are applying pressure, it should be more than the osmotic pressure. If more than the required pressure if you are applying, then the solvent will transfer from high concentration to low concentration. Normally, solvent does not transfer from high concentration to low concentration, but it is possible by applying external pressure which will be more than the required pressure. Now that process of solvent transfer is called reverse osmosis. Osmosis opposite is the reverse. Osmosis means solvent from low concentration to high concentration, whereas reverse osmosis is high concentration side to low concentration side. So during the reverse osmosis we can purify water. Water is mainly purified by reverse osmosis technique. Mostly when we are taking purified water, maybe a water bottle has some name, it is purified by RO technique. When you wash down the bottle, it is purified by RO technique will be there. So RO means reverse osmosis. Because on applying high pressure, only solvent particles will be transferred. So we can get pure solvent on applying high pressure. That is the reverse osmosis. It is used to purify water. Right. So this is about osmosis and osmotic pressure. Now there are some important solutions are there. One is called isotonic solution. So what is isotonic solution means? These are the solutions whose osmotic pressures are equal. Any two solutions whose osmotic pressures are equal, then the two solutions are called isotonic solutions. So osmotic pressure must be same. Now what is osmotic pressure? Formula given m into r into t. This r is a constant. At constant temperature, it again depends on concentration. That means the concentrations are same. That means the solutions are called isotonic solutions. So one of the example is the fluids inside RBC is isotonic with 0.91% W by volume percent of NaCl. So that means the fluids inside RBC, so inside the RBC cells, red blood cells, there are some fluids whose concentrations are exactly equal to the concentration of NaCl, it will be 0.91% weight by volume percent. So what is the concentration of this? Is equal to concentration of fluids of RBC. When both concentrations are same, so osmosis does not occur, because osmosis only applicable when concentrations are different. From low to high osmosis will occur, but when concentrations are same, flow of solvent is not possible. So in isotonic solutions, osmosis will not occur. Similarly, in other solutions are there, hypotonic solution. So what is hypotonic solution means? Any solution whose concentration is less, then the solution is called hypotonic solution. Just for example, we are taking RBC. If RBC we are placed in less concentration. concentrated less concentration than 0.91 W by V NaCl. So the concentration is less than the 0.91% NaCl. Now this less concentrated solution is called hypotonic solution. When we place RBC in hypotonic solution, here RBC concentration exactly equal to 0.91, but the prepared solution is less concentrated. This is less concentrated, now this will become more concentrated. Now solvent will transfer from less concentrated to more concentrated. That means from hypotonic to RBC, solvent will be transferred. So inside the RBC cells, solvent will transfer. So due to transfer of solvent, RBC cells will become swell. That means they will increase as the size. So that is called endoosmosis. Remember, endoosmosis. Endo means when inside water is going, that is called endoosmosis. Same like another is there, hypertonic solution. Hypertonic means more concentrated. Less concentrated is called hypotonic. Hypertonic means more concentrated. If RBC be placed in more than the 0.91 concentrated solution, the solution is more concentrated. Now RBC will become less concentrated. So now from RBC, solvent will be transferred. If solvent is going away from the RBC, the solvent size will become less, that is called shrinking. So in hypertonic solutions, RBC will shrink. In hypotonic solutions, RBC will swell. So this is called endo, whereas this is called exoosmosis, because solvent is going away from the RBC, that is called exoosmosis. In hypertonic and hypotonic, osmosis will occur, but in isotonic, osmosis will not occur. This is the most important. So total all colligative properties, 4 colligative properties we completed. So use the formulas. What are the formulas? First colligative property, RLVP formula, P0A minus PA by P0A is equal to number of moles of A. So number of moles of B by number of moles of A. For dilute solution, so divide NB we can neglect it. Similarly, elevation in boiling point, delta TB is equal to KB into molarity. Depression in freezing point, delta DF is equal to KF into molarity. Osmotic pressure, pi is equal to M into R into T. Number of moles of solute. Molarity also number of moles of solute. Number of moles of solute. Molarity is also number of moles of solute. That means all these properties will depends on number of solute particles only. Whatever the solute we are adding, doesn't matter. Only number of solute particles. Now, there is a one problem is coming by using these properties. So what are the problem is? So we know that colligative properties means it depends on number of moles of solute particles. But these formulas are exactly correct when the solute is, when the solute is non-electrolyte, like urea, glucose, sucrose, etc. If any non-electrolyte solute we are adding, so directly we can use these formulas, there is no option. But when we are coming to electrolytes like NaCl, MgCl2, CH3COOH, HCl, all these are electrolytes. What is electrolyte and non-electrolytes? All you know that. Electrolyte means which can be dissociated into ions. Non-electrolyte means which does not dissociate into ions. So we are using non-electrolytes. So directly we can use this formula. Values are exactly coming. But when we are using non-electrolytes, the calculated values of these colligative properties are very different. That means very far away from the actual values. So So the actual value and observed values, both are different when you are using electrolyte solute. Why? Because first suppose if you are adding 1 mole of NaCl in the water, so in water we are adding 1 mole of NaCl, so we can calculate boiling point derivation or freezing point depression or osmotic pressure, anything we can calculate it. But the calculated value is different from the observed value. So why? Because we expected we are adding 1 mole of solute, so the value is also will come for 1 mole of solute. But actually this NaCl on dissolving in water, it is dissociated to Na plus and Cl minus. This is also solute, this is also solute, both are separated. So this 1 mole, so total 2 moles are coming. We expect only 1 mole solute be added, but the value will come for 2 moles of solute. That means if you have calculated elevation boiling point, that will be double than the whatever we are adding number of moles. If you are adding 1 mole, value will come for 2 moles. So that's why this is not applicable to electrolytes. These formulas are correct for non-electrolytes, but not correct for electrolytes. So that's why to correct this, all these colligative properties, one important factor is introduced. So that is called Van't Hoff factor. So the next topic is Van't Hoff factor. So it is denoted with I. So what actually Van't Hoff factor? So it corrects the colligative properties. Very simple way. It will correct the colligative properties. All colligative properties values are becoming wrong for electrolytes. So that's why to make it correct, we are using one factor, that is called Van't Hoff factor. So the formula of Van't Hoff factor: number of moles after dissociation or association by number of moles before dissociation or association. Another one is also you can use observed colligative property by calculated colligative property. Also we can use normal molar mass by abnormal molar mass. So what is abnormal molar mass? Again you can draw. This is again the same. So I told when we are using electrolytes, colligative property value is changing. When colligative property value is changing, molar mass of solute also change. Why? Because all colligative property depends on number of moles of solute. So moles means molar mass of will come. So when you are calculating molar mass by using colligative property, the value will become different than the actual molar mass. So that is called abnormal molar mass. This abnormality is due to presence of electrolyte. So electrolyte can be dissociate or can be associate also possible. So due to dissociation or association, molar mass will be changed. That is called abnormal molar mass. So these are the three properties you can calculate I value. For example, if you are taking NaCl, when NaCl is dissolved in water, dissociate to 1 Na plus 1 Cl minus. What is the I value? Very simple. Moles after dissociation by moles before dissociation. After dissociation 2 moles. Before dissociation 1 mole. So I value of NaCl is equal to 2. Same like AlCl3. Dissociated to Al3 plus 3 Cl minus. What is the I value? After dissociation 1 plus 3. 4 by before dissociation 1. Similarly, some molecules like acetic acid, CH3COOH, if you are dissolving benzene, C6H6, they undergo association due to hydrogen bond. They undergo association. Association means two moles will combine together, converted to CH3COOH twice. This is the 1 mole. 2 moles converted to 1 mole. Now what is I value? After association 1, before association 2. So I is equal to 1 by 2. So like that, in association I value will be less than 1. In dissociation I value will be more than 1. So that can calculate it by using this formula. Sometimes if the components of electrolyte is weak electrolyte. So weak electrolyte means, for example, taking acetic acid. So if you are dissolved in water, it is dissociated to CH3CO minus plus H plus. But it is a weak electrolyte, that means weak acid, it completely does not dissociate. How much dissociated? Suppose initially we are taking 1 mole. Initially this will be 0. At equilibrium, it is dissociating alpha. This will become alpha, this will become alpha. So what is the I formula? After dissociation by before dissociation. So after dissociation, these two, alpha plus alpha is also there. The remaining 1 minus alpha also there. The total moles after dissociation. 1 minus alpha is remained, plus product alpha divided by before dissociation, number of moles will be 1. So from this, alpha will be cancelled. So I is equal to what? 1 plus alpha. Here alpha is called degree of dissociation or degree of association. Depends on it is undergoing association or dissociation. So like that, dissociation value they will give, or I value they will give, they can ask the dissociation also. So anything is possible. So for example, because different electrolyte has different I values, that's why normally general person, I'm giving An is dissociated to n moles of A. So 1 mole of An is dissociated to n mole of A. So this is a dissociation. So initially 1 mole, it is a 0. Dissociation is alpha. This will become n alpha. So I is equal to 1 minus alpha plus n alpha divided by 1. From this, what is the alpha value you can calculate? 1 will come this side. I minus 1 is equal. Both are having alpha, we are taking common. It will become n minus 1. From this, alpha is equal I minus 1 by n minus 1. So this is for dissociation. Most important formula. So directly you can use this formula. So degree of dissociation is equal to I minus 1 divided by n minus 1. I is the Van't Hoff vector, n is the number of moles. So similarly, for association and writing, n moles of A associated to An. So we can use initially 1, 0, 1 minus alpha, this will become alpha by n. Because it is decreasing, n moles is converted to 1 mole. So 1 mole is converted to 1 by n. So alpha converted to alpha by n. So I is equal to 1 minus alpha plus alpha by n divided by 1. So from this, I minus 1 is equal to alpha, we are taking common, 1 by n minus 1. From this, alpha is equal to I minus 1 by 1 by n minus 1. So this is for association. So direct converse these are, so no need to derivation. So this is for dissociation and this is for association. So degree of dissociation sometimes are lost, degree of association sometimes they will ask. We can use these formulas. So when we are using electrolytes, we must add kind of factor, then only these correct values will come. So by using this I value, colligative properties formulas are changed. So the change in colligative properties, again I am writing, what is the first colligative property relative lowering of vapor pressure? P0A minus PA by P0A is equal NB by NA, number of moles of solute by number of moles of solvent into mass multiplied with I. These I values depends on nature of electrolyte. The degree of dissociation is given, we can directly calculate. Or strong electrolyte is given, so directly we can dissociate. After dissociation by before dissociation, I value will come. Same like elevation in boiling point. Delta TB is equal to KB into M into I. Depression of freezing point. Delta DF is equal to KF into M into I. Osmotic pressure. I is equal to molarity into R into temperature into I. So, without I, the formulas will be incorrect for electrolytes only. Remember, I value we can take only for electrolytes. If the given is non-electrolyte, so I value directly will become 1. Because non-electrolyte does not dissociate it. So I value will be 1. But for electrolyte, I value will be either more than 1 or less than 1. Depends on association or dissociation. So these are the 4 important formulas. Mostly questions will come from these formulas. So another definition is also there. I will explain. See, another definition is there. That one is the azeotropes. So azeotropes. So azeotropes are constant boiling liquid mixtures. So these are nothing but composition of two liquids. So when two liquids we are mixing, that mixture can call azeotrope. But when the two different liquids we are mixing, so each liquid has its own boiling point. Suppose we are mixing 95% volume of ethanol plus 5% volume of water. This volume directly ml we are taking, 95 ml of ethanol and 5 ml of water I am taking. So ethanol has different boiling point. Its boiling point generally will be 78.4 Celsius. Water boiling point we know that 100 Celsius. So ethanol has different boiling point, water has different boiling point. But exactly when 95 ml of ethanol and 5 ml of water we are mixing, so this mixture is called azeotropic mixture. Why it is called azeotropic mixture? Even though both liquid has different boiling points, but after mixing, the two liquids boil at 78.2 degrees Celsius. That means ethanol also boils at this temperature, water also boils at this temperature. So at this temperature, both liquids will be boiled. Such constant boiling liquid mixtures are called azeotropes. So azeotrope definition, these are constant boiling liquid mixtures. Before mixing, it has two different boiling points. But after mixing, the boiling point changes to a constant value. It is decreasing to 78.2, it is also decreasing to 78.2. So the boiling point of the liquid, so boiling point of the mixture is lesser than the individual values, then that azeotrope is called minimum boiling azeotrope. So minimum boiling azeotrope means if the boiling point of the mixture is less than the individual boiling points, then that should be called minimum boiling azeotrope. Ethanol boiling point is 78.4 Celsius. Water has 100 Celsius. But after mixing, it is also decreasing. It is also decreasing to 78.2. A constant value is coming. Such components are called minimum boiling azeotropes. Since boiling point is decreasing, so boiling point decreasing means evaporation will become small. Vapor pressure will be increases, and that will show positive deviation. Minimum boiling azeotropes will show positive deviation from Raoult's law. This is important. Similarly, another example, 68 grams of HNO3 plus 32 grams of water. So this is also azeotrope. 68 grams of HNO3, 32 grams of H2O. This is also HNO3 boiling point nearly 84 Celsius. So, and whereas water boiling point will be 100 Celsius. So, both are different boiling points, but after mixing, its mixture boiling point changes to 120 Celsius. It is also increased, it is also increased. Now, this is called maximum boiling azeotrope. So, azeotropes are two types, minimum boiling azeotrope, maximum boiling azeotrope. So, how we can define? Minimum boiling means, if the boiling point of the mixture will be less than the individual boiling point. If the boiling point of mixture is more than the individual boiling point, then that is called maximum boiling azeotrope. If boiling point is increased, then vaporization decreases, vapor pressure decreases, it will show negative deviation, it will show positive deviation. So this is about azeotropes. So examples are important. Azeotropes are very simple. These are constant boiling mixture. Before mixing, both liquids will boil at different temperature. But after mixing, they boil at constant temperature. The constant boiling liquids are called azeotropes. But the percentage is also most important. So whatever the volume you are not taking, that cannot be azeotrope. So a fixed volume should be there. Exactly 95 ml of ethanol, 5 ml of water will become azeotrope. Here volume is changing, so it cannot become azeotrope. Here 68 grams of HNO3 and 2 grams of water will become azeotrope. So this is about azeotropes. So this is the solution chapter. So here I have given two questions. So solve these two questions, very simple question. So this question is the last year NEET exam question. The Kf for benzene is 5.12 Kelvin kg mole inverse. The depression freezing point of 0.078 molality, small m means molality, of non-electrolyte solute in benzene. So just depression freezing point is asking, just calculate it, options also given. Similarly, another question. 200 ml of aqua solution of protein contains its 1.26 grams. So mass of the protein is given. Osmotic pressure is also given. Temperature is also given. This is asking molar mass. So solve these two questions and send me in WhatsApp group. Thank you.